Good evening. Here we are, Bible School, 2 Corinthians. And as we start, let's pray. Let's pray. Because we want God's presence. We want God to be here. We want to hear from God. We want God to work in our hearts, in our families, in our jobs, in our finances, that we are blessed, but also that we know how to, not just to receive, but also how to give cheerfully. God bless us, bless Belgrade and Serbia and the Balkans, and spreading of the gospel here, because you placed us here for this time and season. Like Esther, we are here for this hour. You have a plan, and we just praise you for this, and we ask you, bless this time, as we said. Again, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We are continuing 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And let's read these verses, and let's have a look on it here. So 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we will come back to this verse, verse 17. And Paul says, therefore, because we are in Christ, we know no man after the flesh. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, it says here, he is a new creature or new creation. And then it says, all things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And this is so beautiful and so amazing. Powerful verses. What does it speak here? Believers, those who received the sacrifice of Jesus Christ for their sins on the cross, personally, for their personal life, for their personal sins, they became believers, and many things happened in the moment of salvation. Okay, we have to understand that the salvation is a moment. It's not a progress, as many people think. For many many spiritual circles, salvation is a way. Salvation is a growth. Salvation is expecting hope, but not sure hope. Many times, salvation for them is something uncertain but hoped for. It could be something you may gain, but not sure if you will keep it, and so on. And it all comes to this one understanding of the verse about the cross. John 19:30, when Jesus says, it is finished, tetelestai, meaning everything has been completed. It's been paid in full. I know if you've ever done accounting, but you have accounting, and at the end, it's a math example, and you just calculate everything, and then it's done. Tetelestai, everything has been calculated together, and you get a final result. And this is what Jesus did at the cross. He paid for all the sins of the whole world. We see it here in 2 Corinthians, repeated many times. That he died for the sins of the whole world. Verse 19, reconciling the world unto himself. And we had a previous class about it. Verse 15, he died for all. Basically speaking about this. Verse 14, also that with one died for all. And speaking about unlimited atonement and a free will decision to be saved. Why I'm saying this? Because basically all the doctrines, and we will touch some of these, we can summarize into like two roots. One type of faith or belief in Christian circles and even outside of Christian circles is works-based salvation. The other approach is a purely grace-faith salvation, and I'll explain it. Well, the works-based salvation, there are groups as all non-Christian religions, for example, because there is always some system of merit. You deserve something, you earn something, meaning orientation to good and bad, not to do bad works and to do good works. And then at the end of your life, God will make summary of your life. And as in the old Egypt, the Egyptians were weighing the heart, well, he will weigh your sins and your good deeds. And based on this, he may take you to heaven or paradise. This includes even the Roman Catholicism. And these works doesn't have to be only good and bad. It can be also based on you have to be part of the church, belonging to the true church, receiving the Eucharist, having some form of baptism. So you have groups which say believe and be baptized in order to be saved. There may be groups which speak about the works in the sense of fruit. You know, you have to prove or show your fruit that you would be saved. And they attached tongue speaking to it as a sign of receiving the Holy Spirit, supposedly. So they believe when you receive the Holy Spirit, you start to speak tongues, and that's the proof that you were saved. So again, it's works-based salvation, because if you don't have this, if you don't have this type of work, you are not saved. So it's about gaining and losing. Then you have a so-called perseverance, you know, in Calvinism, very dangerous teaching. There's a lot of Calvinism in Serbia. It's a very dangerous one of those tulip Calvinism, you know, they speak about limited atonement. They speak about irresistible grace, the grace that you cannot refuse, and it just comes on you and takes over, and you are saved even against your free will. They teach that Jesus died only for the elect, not for the whole world, and thus making Jesus and God's redemptive work as a monster, because God paid only for the elect, not for the others. Then perseverance, one of their points. You have to persevere till the end that you would prove that you are the chosen one. Because they had a problem with people who claim to be elect and then they fallen from their faith. So basically they developed the doctrine of perseverance. If you fall away from us, you are not one of us. This is what they teach. So again, it's works-oriented. But they all forget about important teachings of the scripture, which is justification and regeneration. And these grace, faith, salvation, and I'm referring to Ephesians 2:8, and we will speak about it. It has nothing to do with works at all. So let's look at this. We are a new creation. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. This is very important. You know, once you believe, you are a new creation. The old is gone. Now, there may be people who will say, well, I don't believe in none of these, like gaining heaven for good works or losing it for bad sins. And they will say, I don't even believe in perseverance. I just believe if really you walk away from God and you throw away your salvation back to God and you reject it, then you lose it. Well, that's In other words, perseverance. And even you cannot do this if you understand the biblical teaching of justification and regeneration and the new birth. You know, we can say simply, John 3, Nicodemus coming to Jesus, Jesus tells him, you must be born again or born from above. And of course, the funny question is there, how can old man come back into mother's womb? And Jesus tells him, I speak about heavenly things, about the new heavenly birth. So, as the same way as you were born, you cannot be unborn. You are born to some family. You have the genes of that family. You bear some resemblance of that family. And you belong to that family. And you can do nothing about it. Even if you would be standing on your head and saying, no, 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 I don't want. You are part of that family. The same way, once we are born into God's family, again, we will touch it, we will speak about it. You receive the Holy Spirit, whereby you cry, Abba, Father, in the book of Romans, and you are sealed by it. You belong to new family. Now, speaking about this, in 2 Peter 1:4, there is a verse about 2 Peter 1:4, which says also about things that happened to us. It says, by this you are given, there are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. You know, God promised something, great promises, amazing, precious promises that cannot be changed. That by these you may be partakers of divine nature and escaping the corruption that is in the world through lusts. So it says here that God gave us promises. He called us unto his glory, previous verses, that we may be partakers of divine nature and escaping the corruption that is in the world. You see, divine nature, having part in a divine nature. We have received a new heart, Ezekiel 36:26. The God's character has been revealed to us. We have a word written on our hearts. Again, 2 Corinthians, Paul speaks about it. He says the word is not written on tables of a stone, the ministry of condemnation, but on your hearts, and we have ministry of reconciliation. And we can see now these verses. Let's go back into Peter. We were in 2 Peter. In 1 Peter chapter 1, and we will read here from verses 3. Blessed is God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So he has begotten us again. This begotten us is very important. It's anagenao in the Greek. You know, ana means basically up or to stand or new something. That's why you have the resurrection is anastasis. The name, the lady's name, Anastasia, from it. It means standing up, and stasis is a standing state. So to stand again when he was dead, risen, basically. So here you have it, anagenao, again, genao, regened, basically. He has begotten us. He regenerated us. He gave us new genes. Now think about it. Why? What's the reason? Verse 4, to an inheritance incorruptible. You know, undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. So here he says, we have been redeemed, regenerated. He begotten us. He's our new father. We have his new genes. We belong to him and to his family. to inheritance which cannot be defiled, does not fade away, and is reserved in heaven for us. It's inheritance that we are receiving with Him. For us, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation. Through faith we believed, and now we are kept by the power of God. You cannot keep yourself and make it to heaven. You know, some people think, well, if I live good enough, I will make it there. Or they say, if I don't live so bad, then I will make it there. No, we are kept through faith. Once we believed, we are in His family. Now we are kept by the power of God unto salvation, ready to be revealed in last time. You see, it doesn't say unto salvation and then condition if you and this and this. He says, no, the salvation is ready. The final state of salvation, the glorification, is ready and to be revealed in last time. You know, it's waiting. It's waiting. People in the world, they don't see it yet, but it will be revealed. You know, one day when the trump comes, with the trumpet, when we are changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, it will be revealed. It will be glorious. You know, now we will, then we will see. Now we don't see, we believe, but then we will truly see. So these are all verses about eternal security of believer. And he says that we greatly rejoice in it. Then he speaks about temptation, trial of faith, that we, verse 8, having not seen Jesus Christ you love, we love Him. Verse 9, receiving the end of your faith, which is the salvation of your souls. You see, so he is again reaffirming them, reassuring them, and saying, you will be receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. You know, don't try to bring there like end of the faith is like if your faith is persevering, then you will receive it. No, it doesn't say. It says very clearly, the end of your faith. What's my faith? My faith is that Jesus died for me on the cross. This is my faith. That's how it started. That's how it continues. And that will be the end of my faith. You know, the culmination of the faith. When we are brought into this state of glorification. And this is amazing. And let's look into Romans chapter 8, because we speak now about these results of our faith, results of salvation. But let's look at the progress, at the steps. The book of Romans chapter 8. And we can read here. Romans 8, 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. No condemnation. Okay? Those who walk not after the flesh, unbelievers, but after the Spirit, those who received the Spirit. Because he adds in verse 9, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. And if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. This is a very clear understanding. There are people in the flesh and people in the Spirit. There are unbelievers and believers, and we have this Spirit. And then he says here, verse 14, for as many as are now governed by the Spirit of God, because we are not anymore under the authority of the flesh, authority of the world and the Satan. We are in a new family. We are in the kingdom of His marvelous light. We are now governed by the Spirit. We are the sons of God. And you have not received the spirit of bondage, again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. You see, that's That's the salvation which happened to us. We have received the spirit of adoption. Now we are new. We have a father. Now we cry, Abba, Father, because we belong to family. Now we are under the government of the spirit, not of the flesh and the world. And then it says, verse 16, and the spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Not that we will be one day when we behave, but we are already. And then he continues, and if children, then heirs, heritors, inheritors, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. What Christ will inherit, we will inherit. Now we are already on the list of inheritors. Again, there is no condition like, well, you are on the list of inheritors, but because you did not persevere, at the end you live a gross life and you left God, well, therefore you will not inherit it. No, this is something which is done forever. And if so be willing, if so be we suffer with him, if it happens, we will even suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Verse 18, but remember, sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Now, verse 19, there is a great expectation of the creature waiting for manifestation of the sons of God. You see, all the creation is waiting for us to be manifested. It's a fact that happened already, and it will be manifested. For we know that the whole creation, verse 22, groans and travails in pain together until now. Verse 23, the B part, and they are waiting for the adoption to witness the redemption of our body. You see, they are waiting for it. These are like sure words of salvation. Verse 29. For whom he, and there is this golden chain, for whom he did foreknew, you see, God had a foreknowledge, he saw the future beforehand, he also did predestinate. You see, predestination is coming after foreknowledge to be conformed to the image of his son. So God saw before that we will believe, so he predestinated us to be conformed to the image of his son. We are predestinated in Christ that he might be the firstborn among brethren. Now moreover, whom he predestinate, he also called, he called us, and whom he called, he also justified, and whom he called, whom he justified, them he also glorified. This is an amazing change. So God sees the future, he foreknew, then he predestinated, then he called us. When he called us, then he justified us and glorified, the final glorification. There's the whole chain. And then why it says verse 31? What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Then who can lay anything, verse 33, any charge against God's elect? Nobody, because it's God who justifies. This is very important. The doctrine of justification and also regeneration, we will touch it. Once we are justified, it means that on our account has been ascribed God's righteousness. And to God's account, Jesus Christ, has been ascribed our sins and our sin nature, that he was, that he died for the sin of the whole world. So this is this exchange. Once you believe, God sees you in Jesus Christ righteousness. That's justification. And then, as we said First Peter 3, that he begotten us anagenao, and Titus speaks about generation, regeneration, also in another words. And you have it here. Let me see this. So if you find Titus chapter 3 verse 5, and it says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, no, not by works, but according to his mercy he saved us. You see, never is salvation works based. And then it says, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. So we were washed of regeneration. Washing of regeneration, the Greek word is polygenesia. Again, polygenao, this is meaning new genes. So we have been renewed in our genes. That's why it says beautifully, gene regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. Anakaino. Ana, we spoke about it. It means new or up. And kaino is new. So basically here it speaks about raising up the newness. We've been regenerated and renewed by the Holy Spirit. And then verse 7, that being justified by his grace. You see, we are justified. Romans 5:1, therefore being justified. We are justified. It's not like if I live well, at the end I will be justified because of my works and performance and goodness and faithfulness. No. It's not like if you have been justified and then if you persevere, if you keep your salvation, if you don't so-called fall from grace, then you will be justified at the end. No, you've been justified, it's done deal. And it says that, again, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. We are heirs, again. You are on a list of inheritors. These are all legal terms. It has nothing to do with our works, with our perseverance, keeping the faith, and so on. And then we could go into Ephesians chapter 2. Galatians, Ephesians chapter 2. And we can start here. Verse 5. Even when we were dead in sins, God has quickened us or made us alive together with Christ. By grace you are saved. And has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So you see, we were dead before, then God quickened us. We will see how, it's explained here. And then he made us raised from the dead and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We are already seated above. We are already there. That in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Jesus Christ. So in the ages to come in the future, he will reveal it, that we are already seated above. And then it says, not of works, lest any man, verse 8, sorry, for by grace you are saved, through faith, and not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Now, when you speak with the Calvinists, they say the regeneration comes before faith and before salvation, basically. They say that because the person is desperately wicked, we are not able to respond to God. Therefore, God, by his irresistible, meaning you cannot reject it, grace comes upon you. He regenerates you, and then you are able to be saved by God. Because they're afraid that faith is a work. But here it says it's not. You can read it in other passages. But here it says very clearly, for by grace you are saved through faith. and not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Why somebody says that faith is works? It says here, no, it's not. First, okay, let's read the scripture as it is. Faith is not works. Second, when you truly study and when you understand, it says here, for by grace you are saved. And here it says, in the Greek, by grace or according to grace, you are saved through faith. Very good. The Greek word through faith is not because of faith, as some say, because of your faith you are saved. No, not at all. It says here through, very good translation. It means dia in the Greek, and dia means, as it says, through faith. Through faith, and we could say, because this is I believe genitive case in the Greek, and Greek has many usages of genitive cases. One can be through faith, or we could say like through the night. You know, you do something through the night. You do something through faith. It could be time frame. It could be also place and so on. But it's never work. And actually here it says through faith. And I want to see it. How is it in Daničić, Karadžić? So when we look into the Ephesians chapter 2. Verse 8, it says, jer ste blagodaču spaseni kroz vjeru. A to nije od vás, dary Boží, ne od djela, da se niko ne pochváli. Amazing, kroz vjeru, kroz vjeru. Through faith, through something, not because of. So through this faith. Now, how faith comes? Faith comes by hearing Romans 10:17, right? Faith comes by hearing. And now you see it. There is the work of the Holy Spirit. He works in your environment many times, also in your heart. He's preparing you. But mainly faith comes by hearing. How they can hear if they do not, how they can believe if they do not hear. And how they can hear if nobody goes and brings the gospel. It's Romans 10 and Romans 10, 17. But then faith comes by hearing. The missionary comes. Somebody comes to you. Somebody gives you a Bible. Somebody gives you a flyer from our church. Somebody tells you that Jesus loves you and explains you. And you get mad and you don't believe it. But hey, faith comes by hearing. You hear it first. And seed has been planted. And you know, as you think about it, you start to believe it. Because you hear the good news that Jesus died for your sins and there is salvation. And you realize in yourself, I am lost, I need this. It's all by grace that the person came to you. It's all by grace that the gospel is here, revealed to us all. It's all by grace that in the jungle when people don't have the Bible, somebody brings the Bible to them. Or even the angel can appear and preach to them. But in nowadays, mostly missionaries, you know, people are being used the same way as disciples. And God, through His grace, brings a preacher, brings an evangelist, brings a friend who tells you about Christ. And faith comes by hearing. And then, by grace, through this faith, you just simply say, I believe it. I believe it, I need to be saved. And based on a free will response to the message of grace and salvation, you are saved. In that moment, you are justified in the sight of God. You are regenerated by the Holy Spirit, as we said. You become the Son of God in Romans 8:15, adoption 16. We are the children, heirs, joint heirs. We will be glorified. Romans 8:28, and the whole chain is there. What happens? God foresaw, He saw it. Therefore, He predestinated us in Christ, justified. Whom He justified, He called and then glorified. So these are all sure things which will happen if somebody places his faith. And then, as we spoke about these verses, 1 Peter 1, 3 to 9, and I believe it was also 2 Peter 1, 4, we are regenerated, redeemed, and we are receiving the end of our faith, which is salvation. You see, now it all makes sense. 1 John 2, 2. Amazing verses. Again, 1 John chapter 2, verse 2. And he, Jesus Christ, is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Okay? So here you see the unlimited atonement, propitiation for the sins of the whole world. Very clear teaching. Don't bring up other verses which seem to be contrary to this. This is very clear. You know, there is no doubt about this. And 1 John 3, 2, and then it says, beloved, so now, because we believed, we are the sons of God. And it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him. You see, now we are the sons of God. It's not visible yet, but when he comes back for us, it will be released, it will be shown to the whole world, to the whole creation, which is groaning and waiting for the sons of God, for the children of God to be manifested. Everybody is waiting. It's a sure thing. It's not like they are waiting and some will be lost. No. 1 Corinthians 12, read about the members of the church. You know, we are the members in particular, very precise place God gave us. You know, everybody has his part and role in it. Now, another thing is if he stays home or comes to the church, because here in the church, in a gathering of believers, he can exercise and use his gifts. The gifts are for the church, for the body, not for being alone at home. And we are members, and none of the members of Jesus Christ will end up in hell. You cannot be a member of the body of Christ and then to be dismembered. You know, you are a finger and then they will cut the finger and throw it into hell because you were disobedient. No. We spoke about things like God's chastisement to bring us back into fellowship with him. But pertaining salvation, it's a sure thing. There are many errors, teachings, and let's say Calvinism. We mentioned Calvinism with its tulip. And I don't have to name it here all, but simply they are rejecting that Jesus died for all. They say that Jesus died only for some. That's the limited atonement. They are denying the free will of a person to choose salvation and choose God. They say it's irresistible grace. You cannot reject it. It comes upon you and against your will, it saves you. But others are not chosen and they are left out to go to hell. So there is no urge. There is no ministry of reconciliation. As we are studying here in 2 Corinthians, Paul speaks about it. Well, they are denying this and making God a literally monster. Because God saves only those whom he wants. Arminianism is the other extreme. And also it's wrong. At least they recognize the God dying for all, unlimited atonement. They believe in a free will salvation, that God died for all, but it's forgiveness and justification is applied to all those who receive it by faith. Nevertheless, Arminianism believe you can lose your salvation. It's again works oriented. The Calvinism is so afraid of these works, that's why they go into the extreme, but they end up with the works because they believe in perseverance. Again, you have to stay faithful to God till the end to show that you were the chosen. If you don't, if you fall away from grace, so-called, you are lost forever, as well as Arminianism. There is another group of people, Unitarianism. You know, they believe that only those who believe in Christ's saving work will be saved, and it's a very small number, and others go to hell. Nevertheless, they believe that the hell is not forever, and in the end, all people will be unified with God. So basically, there is no need for Christ dying for some, because all will be unified at the end. Something similar like purgatory teaching. You know, if you do not really believe, you end up in purgatory for 300 years, and then at the end you will get out of it and you will be unified with God. You know, similar wrong teaching, very similar. Pelagianism, you know, another error doctrine. Pelagianism, they say that children are born without sin. You know, and they again believe that the little children are beautiful and without a sin. And read Romans 3:23. All have sinned. All. It doesn't say that only those who are 12 years and up. No, all have sinned. You know, and my mother conceived me in a sin, says David, I believe in Psalm 51. He speaks about the sinful nature, old sin nature that we have, till we are redeemed, till the final perfection and glorification comes. So this is just all the groups that you see, they are adding something to salvation, and it all comes from not understanding justification, regeneration, and basically Romans 8:28 and so on, the whole chain of God's work. They don't understand Ephesians 2:5 till 8 and 9, that according to grace, through faith, we are saved. Faith which came by hearing, we've heard the word of God, faith came, and we decided out of our free will to act upon it, and we were saved. Once saved, always saved. If you have a problem with this doctrine, please talk to us, send us comments, send us email, or we go for coffee and we talk. It's very important to understand this. Otherwise, you will live in work-based salvation. There will be always some type of works included in it. And you may call it, no, I don't mean works, I mean something else. Well, it's works. Because here it says it's only by grace, through faith, not of your works. No works. The works are excluded. If it's by grace, then it's not of works. Otherwise, we would make a God debtor. It's in Romans, we are teaching about this. And if it's by grace, it cannot be of works. So let's rejoice in this amazing teaching. What God has done for us, these things that can be reverted back. You know, once born again, you cannot be unborn. Once regenerated, you cannot be unregenerated. Once you are adopted into God's family, you cannot be thrown away if you misbehave or walk away from God or say, I don't want to do anything with God anymore. No, God will chasten you to bring you back, but he will never leave you. That's why he says it, never. Never means never. You know, you may have a bad moment and you turn against God because horrible things happen in your life and you get bitter and angry and you curse God and you leave God, and in this moment God would leave you and say, okay, go to hell, you don't want to do nothing with me. No, God is after you, God is there for you. And he wants to bring you back for fellowship, but you never lose sonship. If you read the epistles of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd epistle of John, they are beautiful and they deal exactly with this teaching. They speak about the fellowship with God and the sonship. And the sonship can never be lost. We can lose fellowship. Therefore, if we confess sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and bring us back into fellowship. That's the passage. But never you lose sonship, and then you confess and you regain your sonship again, and then you do something horrible and you lose it and then you regain it. No, that's not the point. It's like a marriage. You know, we are married unto God through the blood of the Lamb. In the marriage, you have a ring, you belong one to another. It's for good. It cannot change. And the only thing you confess, not in a sense you confess, like, can I be your husband again? Because I didn't put the dirty dishes into dishwasher. I'm sorry, can I be your husband again? No, you are husband, but you confess for renewing the fellowship. I'm sorry, please, can, you know, I didn't do this. I recognize, you know, let's have a great time. Let's talk again. You know? So let's be normal. Let's understand the scripture as it is. Otherwise, we will fall into works-based salvation. And it doesn't matter how you call it. If it's Calvinism, Arminianism, Unitarianism, Pelagianism, or whatever, Catholicism, Orthodox faith, it's all works-based salvation. But when you come to the scripture and you realize it's a grace, faith-based salvation. We are saved according to grace through dia, through faith, which came by hearing. We heard, we believed, and we said that's the way we are saved. And don't be afraid. Faith decision is not the works. Ephesians 2:8-9 speaks about it. It's not of works. It's not of yourself. So this is beautiful teaching. And let's study this. If anything is unclear to you, please study, pray before you study. Let's lay aside all the concepts and the baggage that we could have brought from our background. You know, some people have a background of different teachings in the churches and cultures and so on, and in the families, and just God speak to us and make this clear to those that do not understand this yet. This is what we pray in your precious name. Amen. Thank you.